brothers and sisters are Isabel, 4 years older, and Paul, who was born when I was 13.
My life is brilliant. My love is pure. I saw an angel. Of that I'm sure. She smiled at me on the subway.
And Paul Gallagher and Sarah McGuire Gallagher. My parents.
Now you're 100% Irish.
I am 100%.
Father and mother.
Father and mother. Grew up in Malvern, Pennsylvania. It was the country. In fact, you could walk to the town, which we did do, but it was 3 miles. We used to walk to the neighbor's swimming pool, to rich neighbors who had a pool. 2 little girls in their bathing suits walking all that way. Nobody worried. And the butler would come down and bring us a Coke with a bunch of ice, and we got a whole Coke, which we never had at home. We thought that was great. I went to school at St. Patrick's in Malvern, but then the war came, and my dad had to go work in the defense plant. So I had to go to public school, and I was scared to death. And I would stand up to answer, and a couple times I said to the teacher, "Yes, sister," and the kids would all laugh.
Isabel's younger or older?
Isabel's older.
4 years.
4 years.
Oh, I love her. She went away to go to high school, so I was by myself out there a lot. There wasn't anything to do, so I just had to make up things. You just went down and played in the woods. The cat was a panther. I would make the black cat be a panther. My dog was a lion. I used to swing from the trees. I was Sheena of the jungle. I'm shy. I know you kids don't believe I am, but I am a very shy person. And the one thing that did surprise me, in high school, I was in the drama club, and I wasn't shy then because you can be somebody else. But to be yourself, like to get up and do readings at church, that's not me. Loved high school. I was a cheerleader. I went with a boy who was on the football team. And Marg Burns, she was in my class. We were good friends.
Wow, I didn't know that.
She was a cheerleader also. And we would double date and eat we'd go to the movies or something. Then we'd go to a burger place and have milkshakes and burgers. And we'd go back to her house and eat some more.
When you were a kid growing up, did you guys go to church every Sunday? I mean, how far was the church?
It was 3 miles, but we never missed Mass. My father was a stronger Catholic than my mother, but my mother was really a better person. My dad had been in the priesthood, and his eyes were bothering him, and so the doctor said, "You have to get out and go back in if you want. There's too much studying," and my grandmother said, "The doctor was an agent of the devil because she didn't want him to come out." He came from 10 children, and two girls were nuns and one was priest. But Daddy came out, met Mother, and that was a very tumultuous affair. Those two were back and forth. No, I got along great with Mom. She was a very calm mother. One time I said, "Mother, I think I'll take up smoking," because she smoked. She threw the pack across and said, "Light up." And I thought, "Oh, she's going to say that's not going to be any fun."
That's not going to be fun.
So I never did smoke. And we had a party line. And at night, as I say, there was nothing to do. There was no TV. So I'd be on the phone talking to people. And the party line, there was a very wealthy neighbor up the street. He couldn't have a private phone either because it was just
Oh, so it was
him.
A party line, as in you pick up the phone and people
and
are on the phone.
And hear people speaking. And he knew me so well that he'd say, "Bar, could I have the phone?" And I said, "Oh, okay, got to hang up." The neighbor wants to call.
Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started to hum. Still, it's a real good bet, the best is yet to come.
First memory of him, I had even forgotten, but he told me, My mother would pick him up. He would be thumbing on the road to go swimming at the swimming hole. And he said, I remember you were this little bratty kid in the back seat of the car. And then mother would drop him off. And always, he remembered her because she always tipped well at the Acme when he bagged her groceries. He'd carry him out to the car for her. But when I would be riding the bus, I'd see Dad. He would be walking to work at the pharmacy. And I didn't even know him, but he was tall and nice looking. And I used to say to the kids on the bus, look, he's even following my bus. You know, and he didn't, I said, look at that. And they'd all laugh.
This high school?
He was 2 years ahead of me, so when I was a senior at the senior prom, they crown a prom queen. And my date was the boy I went with then, who was in the football team. I ended up being the queen, and Dad was at the prom with another girl who had asked him to take her, and he came over and asked me to dance. And, I was just thrilled. I don't know what that song was then, but our song was Bewitched later on. You know, then the first night he asked me out, I can remember just being so nervous. And I was spending the night with a girlfriend, and I came back, and the girl's sister, older sister, liked him. And she said, did he ask you out again? Like, she knew he hadn't. And I said, yeah, he's coming over to my house tomorrow. And she about swallowed her teeth. He was in college at that point and going to pharmacy school, and then he'd work at the drugstore when he came back. Earl's Pharmacy on the corner in Paoli, right down the street from his house, so he could walk. So he went to officer's training school.
Bombardier or something like that.
He was a navigator.
He was
a navigator, and he loved it. Then I went to work at Devereux Schools as a secretary, and I loved it. I got to go to the AMA convention and tell people all about the school, kind of like you do with Wolfgang.
Oh.
And one day, I was in Malvern, and Dad and I had broken up, and we were back and forth, and all of a sudden I was asking about it. I must have been asking God if it was going to work out with us, and I heard bells. I told my dad this too, and there were no bells, you know, so I thought, that's probably my first little experience about that.
I'm wild again, beguiled again, a simpering, whimpering child again, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I.
After we got married, we were sent to Salina, Kansas. We lived in a second floor apartment in Salina, Kansas that had, we painted the floors and they never dried.
This was the painting floor before the party?
It was, and we had a Murphy bed, a metal Murphy bed that you push together. And Dad would be at the base to spend the night because he was officer of the day or whatever we did. And there were roaches. We lived near an old bakery, and there were roaches. I was scared to death of them. I'd be under the bed trying to get them up in the metal box springs. I still am. And there was a space heater in the little bathroom. It had a living room, a stairway that came up from upstairs, a living room, a kitchen, a bedroom, and a little tiny bath. That was the extent of it. And the space heater in the bathroom, you know, so that kind of kept you a little bit warm. We would be in bed at night and pretend it was a campfire. And you really had to have a good imagination.
These are the romantic evenings.
These were the romantic evenings.
Because what
and
age?
A big night was to, I was 22. A big night was to walk down to the Krispy Kreme. It wasn't Krispy Kreme, but it was some donut place. And get a hot, warm donut just out of the, that was a big night.
Just like the Krispy Kreme,
right,
so warm donut.
Right. I had Sharon there. And then the next base was Waco, Texas, a year later. I had Bill in Waco, Texas. And then the next base, we really lucked out, Palm Beach Air Force Base. And I had to fly home to have Jeff because Bill was being discharged. We went home to stay. And Dad got a job as a pharmacist in Berwyn at Connor's Pharmacy. and we stayed one winter. He did us in. We had sand in our shoes. The guy he worked for in Palm Beach wanted him to come back, West Palm actually. And so we contacted him. He said he'd love to have us, and we moved back. And then Mark was born in Boynton Beach. We came back to Florida. We lived first in Lantana. Mark and Patty were born there, and then Mary Beth. And then when Mary Beth was, I think, 2 months, she was born in December, we came up in March. And we moved up to Winter Park. I had everybody except Barbie, Sean, and Justin. And Dad had to work 7 o'clock in the morning until sometimes 2 o'clock in the morning. I was on my own. I didn't know anybody. I loved it in Lantana. And I loved the beach down there. And he kept saying to me, just come up and take a look at everything and you see how you like it. Just take a look at it. So we came up, and the house that Patty lives in now, we looked at it. We came up in shorts. It was cold. They had had a freeze. Our things didn't arrive. We were freezing cold, and I thought, I am going to hate it here. Everything was brown, and everything in Lantana was green and pretty.
Killed everything.
And the beach. And so he said, just write down on one side of the book what you like about it and what you don't like about it on the other side, and then we'll decide. So I went in, and I'm starting to write this, and he's upstairs with the realtor, and when he walked down, I said, where is he? He said, oh, I'm going out to get the papers. Your husband just bought this house. What?
What about the list?
He hasn't seen my list. But after we got up there, and I had gone next door to Kay Albacher, and I said, are there any children on this street? I have got 5 kids. And I, what's the matter here? She said, they're all in for naps. Don't worry, there's more kids than you can shake a stick at. So Jack and Nancy finally came up, and we liked them. And we'd get together because both of our husbands were working so much. And Jackie and Ray Walters lived down the street, and the kids all played with the Walters.
How did we meet the Walters?
Everybody we met was through church. Father Wells was there, and we would help out with the newcomers and all that. Industrious, plotter, stuck with it. Bill, I would say, a neatnik. I mean, the Navy probably did that to him. Jeff is, you're right, Jeff's mellow, anything goes. Mark was very studious and just loved to learn. Patty was fun. I mean, Patty is crazy. so surprised that she's such a hard worker, because Patty, growing up, she and I were like, oh, oil and water. She was just, Patty's a marcher. Mary Beth is very mellow. I think Mary Beth is very mellow, but in later years, hard, hard, hard worker. Barbie is Barbie of the rules. Barbie has the rules and she follows them and follows through on things. Sean is more serious. I think Bill and John are the more serious ones. But hard worker has definitely got stick-to-itiveness. Justin is fun-loving, but has surprised me. For being the youngest child, he surprises me that he is so in charge. Likes to be in charge of things.
What makes you happy?
Reading makes me happy, to get lost in a book. Traveling. This, the woods. My kids, my family.
What is the core four? What's that all about?
The core four keeps switching around. Every once in a while they change. And the core four are the quick ones who make fun and
meanest.
Tease.
Sarcastic.
The teasers. That would be definitely Bill. Sharon is not in the core four and probably never has been. Jeff is very quick, and
Bill's a lifetime member.
Bill's the president. And then they switch around with Patty and Barbie. And then one of them said, Mom, you're one of the core four. I think sarcasm is the rule. And Dad was not sarcastic at all. So it comes from the Irish, the Gallaghers, I think. That's sarcasm.
That side. How would you describe Dad?
A rock. Just the best thing that ever happened to me. The absolute very best.
If I had my life to live over, still do the same things again, still want to roam in that place that I call home, that's where my happiness
would never end. And I'll meet you when school days were over. We would walk through the lanes we once knew. If I had my life to live over, I'd still fall in love with you.
I just can't believe that it went. People say, well, you never fought. Well, my parents fought and his parents fought. And I think we probably were so aware of that that we didn't. And some people said that's not normal, but it was normal for us. We got from each other, and that's one thing. He kept things in, and he'd be quiet, and I'd keep bugging him to say, get it out. And in later years, he said, keep at me, because he thinks that's what, I'm sure that's what gave him an ulcer.
So stress-wise, he kept it in.
Right. When, after Dad died, not long after Dad died, when I went home, I thought, oh, here I am with nobody to talk to this about, not to say what could I take or how long is this going to be or anything. I felt so alone. And I walked in the house and heard the bird chirping as loudly, not just like the red bird goes, tick, tick, tick. This was, and I ran upstairs, and on the windowsill, his side of the bed, was the red bird just chattering loudly and fast, and I burst into tears, and I knew that he was saying, it's all right, chill. Well, my perfect days were in the past when Dad and I would be off.
Traveling.
Those were my perfect days. But my perfect days now are being with my kids. I wanted to write, so I keep thinking. And that's maybe one thing I would do up here if I was up by myself, is sit and write. I always felt like I had a book in me.
What do you think this book would be about? What would the storyline, if you...
Oh, it would definitely be a love story. Well, they say write about what you know, so it would be, I'd have to draw on personal experience. But if I wrote a book about my life with kids and some of the things that have happened, I just don't think that would fly very well.
You can't you write about the nice parts?
Well, you got to cover it all. You want to make it a little salacious.
Yeah.
One time they wanted Dad to run for mayor of Maitland. I said, are you kidding? With the trouble our boys have gotten into when they were teenagers, they'll drag up all that. We're not going to.
If you had a chance to sit down and have a conversation with anyone, who would it be?
Brad?
Well, of course it would be God, because I would like to find out why were certain things done, you know? Why did he decide this? Why did he decide that? And who says this? Or were these just man-made rules? You know, I'd like to ask him the nitty-gritty, get down to basics.
That's a good one. What message would you leave for your grandchildren and great-grandchildren? What advice would you give them?
That would be the same thing I've always said for my kids. Stay close to God, and everything else will fall in place. It just sounds so simplistic, but it's true.
Making this hard on myself when there's so many beautiful reasons I have to be happy. Got my friends, got the sunshine above. Why am I making this hard on myself when there's so many beautiful reasons I have to be happy?